good? Oh, there we go. We had that microphone working last week, and this week, not so much. But I'll tell you what, I love borrowing this microphone from the, was it the drama club? Wow, great microphone. We'll have to put that on the list of wishes. Hey, everybody, welcome to Bethlehem. It's great to see you. Welcome to those of you who are joining us online as well as we come to worship our Lord and Savior in this third week of Easter. Ooh, we need to light the Easter candle. That's okay. I didn't tell anybody about that Easter candle. That Easter candle is a reminder that Jesus Christ is alive and well and with us. It stays lit until Ascension Day. So if someone could get up there and light that one, that would be great. Appreciate it very, very much. Hey, last week, I wanted to let you know what was going on last week. We took a trip to, guess what's not working now? I wonder, will this work here? If I turn this on, will that work? Okay, last week we took five of our confirmation kids, not the whole class, just five of them, to Okoboji Lutheran Bible Camp, and it was an amazing weekend. I actually was exhausted before I left because of all the time I spent with my daughter at the Mayo Clinic the week before, but these kids were fantastic. They were so into the Word and so connected to each other. It was just a fantastic time. Next slide. I can't do it. So we had a lot of fun. They played a thing called Gaga Ball, which I wasn't going to play because it looked a little too rough. But I did teach them how to play some pickleball, and we had a good time playing pickleball. We learned how to keep the score correctly and everything. It was just a blast. Next slide shows some teamwork. They had us do team building skills, one of the things was they had us do a shipwreck game where we had to float on the ocean on pieces of wreckage from the plane, and it kept getting smaller and smaller and smaller. The smallest was a one-foot box where we got six people on the box, a one-foot box, and I'm on there somewhere with five of the kids. We actually did it. When we finished the task, we said, write it down, we are Bethlehem Buffalo Center, we did it. And then we had to flip over a magic carpet, because the magic carpet was flying upside down, so we had to flip it over without falling off. That was that second one. Next slide. They did some learning. So on the left there, they had 20 Bible events, and they were told to go and then put the 20 Bible events in a row. And I'm happy to say that our kids did great. In fact, they got almost all of it right on the first try. They just had the flood a little bit too late and threw a few other things off. But the kids really know their Old Testament and life of Christ, which was our big effort this year, was to teach them the Old Testament and life of Christ. We had some song time and some devotions with this great staff from the camp. It was fantastic. Next is we also had campfires and food. We had a lot of food. We never ran out of food. We had food everywhere. And so thanks to Jen and Shirley for feeding us and being part of the weekend as well. That's what I have for that. A quick announcement or two before we get going. First of all, Sunday school today will be over with at 11 o'clock. You want to set that up? Thanks. Just take the whole thing. Yeah. Sunday school will be over with at 11 o'clock today. Remember that there is a family movie being shown at the Lake Mills Theater, and everyone's invited to go to that. It's free, right? Yep, it's free. And we're encouraging folks to head on over there at 11 o'clock for that noon showing. And also, it is Jen's birthday today. Happy birthday, Jen. Happy birthday. Well, we should probably do a short chorus. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jen. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Yeah. And I think with that, we... What's that? Oh, that's right. Thank you for reminding me. So today, we are returning to a short fellowship time after church in the fellowship hall. We have worked to understand how we should relax some of our COVID standards. So we are not taking temperatures at the beginning of the service. If you feel sick, then just don't come, okay? If you feel sick, that's the thing to do. Don't come. We were screening with temperatures just to stop people at the door if they were having that one major symptom. So, you're free to take your mask off in church if you prefer. If you want to keep it on, you're welcome to keep it on. We will do whatever to make you comfortable and safe. As always, the room over here is still mask only during church, so you can go in there. The curtain's closed. I don't even know if anybody's in there right now, but that's what we're doing now with the COVID restrictions. I am so happy to see more and more of our church life kind of coming along. And so we do still want to stay safe, so please bear that in mind, okay? Are there any other announcements from last week's council meeting and so forth? I wasn't there. I was having fun in Okoboji. Okay. All right. Let's begin. I don't even know where we're at. Oh, good. There's a song. That way we can get my tablet going. Okay. Let's stand and sing. Sing to the King. I think we'll not sing that one. That one's kind of a hard tune to catch on to. Do you need a password? We might have to abandon the tablet. I have some good friends visiting from Owatonna, and they're probably saying, that's our mark. What's new? Tech problems.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation, His empire shall bring. Joy to the nations when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing a song.
merciful God, we confess that apart from Christ, we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you, God, word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. By the authority of Christ himself, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you please pray with me? God of abundance, you made yourself known to us in the breaking of bread, and revealed to us the mystery of your life, death, and resurrection through the Scriptures. Embolden us to live our lives in ways that bear witness to who we are, one in Christ our Lord, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The first reading will be from Acts 3, 11 through 21. They all rushed out in amusement as Solomon's colonnade, where the man was holding tightly to Peter and John. Peter saw his opportunity and addressed the crowd. "People of Israel," he said, "what is so surprising about this? And why stare at us as though we had made this man walk by your own power or godliness? For it is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of all our ancestors, who has brought glory to his servant Jesus by doing this. This is the same Jesus whom you handed over and rejected before Pilate, despite Pilate's decision to release him. You rejected this holy righteous one, and instead demanded the release of a murderer. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. And we are witness of this fact. Through faith in the name of Jesus, this man was healed. And you know how crippled he was before. Faith in Jesus' name has healed him before your very eyes. Friends, I realize what you and your leaders did to Jesus was done in ignorance. But God was fulfilling what all the prophets had foretold about the Messiah, and he must suffer these things. Now, repent of your sins and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away. Then times of refreshment will come from the presence of the Lord, and he will again send you Jesus, your appointed Messiah. And he must remain his main in heaven until the time for the final restoration of all things, as God promised long ago through his holy prophets. This is the word of the Lord.
Stand and join me in speaking Psalm 4 as it is printed on the screen. You'll read the highlighted parts of the bold parts. Answer me when I call to you, O God, who declares me innocent. Free me from my troubles. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. You can be sure of this. The Lord set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will answer when I call to him.
Don't sit on my hand before the Lord.
Think about it
overnight and remain silent.
Offer sacrifices in the right spirit and trust the Lord.
Many people say, who will show us better times? Let your face smile upon us, Lord.
You have given me greater joy than those who have abundant harvests of grain and new wine.
In peace I will lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, will keep me safe.
Please be seated. I was kind of wondering what kind of interlude we were going to get out of you guys. You know, the Psalms are a songbook, and there are notations there for the musicians. We should have at least had a na-na-na or something in there. but sorry about that little slip of the word in there. We have the scriptures just as they're printed for us and given to us, and those little interludes are slipped in there in the Psalms.
The second reading, John 3:1-7. See how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his children, and that is what we are. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children because they don't know him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is. And all who have this eager expectation will keep themselves pure, just as he is pure. Everyone who sins is breaking God's law, for all sin is contrary to the law of God. And you know that Jesus came to take away our sins, and there is no sin in him. Anyone who continues to live in him will not sin, but anyone who keeps on sinning does not know him or understand who he is. Dear children, don't let anyone deceive you about this. When people do what is right, it shows that they are righteous, even as Christ is righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
All right. The gospel, according to Luke 24:36-49. Please rise. And just as they were telling about it, Jesus himself was suddenly standing there among them. Peace be with you, he said. But the whole group was startled and frightened, thinking they were seeing a ghost. Why are you frightened, he asked. Why are your hearts filled with doubt? Look at my hands. Look at my feet. You see that it's really me. Touch me and make sure that I'm not a ghost, because ghosts don't have bodies as you see that I do. As he spoke, he showed them his hands and his feet. Still, they stood there in disbelief, filled with joy and wonder. Then he asked them, do you have anything here to eat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he ate it as they watched. Then he said, when I was with you before, I told you that everything written about me in the law of Moses and that the prophets and in the Psalms must be fulfilled. Then he opened his minds to understand the scriptures. And he said, yes, it is written long ago that the Messiah would suffer and die and raise from the dead on the third day. It was also written that this Messiah would be proclaimed in the authority of his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. There is forgiveness of sins for all who repent. You are witness of all these things. And now I will send the Holy Spirit, just as my Father promised. But stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. If you feel up to it, just stay standing for the song. It helps you sing louder and better.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing.
watch the darkness flee.
We're putting a few backup items in place just in case things go kaflooey. Hey, I want to talk to you today about being open for business. And that's what struck me as soon as I read this text. It was as if there was an opportunity for me to address the idea of being open for business. Now, we're reading from Luke chapter 24, and we've had some other scripture lessons from Luke 24 in the past few weeks. So I want to throw some context into our gospel lesson for today. We have an event that is taking place that Jesus is appearing to the disciples. A couple things have happened before this. First of all, that morning, the women were at the tomb. The body was gone. Peter checked it out. And we had disciples who were walking on the road to Emmaus and walked along with Jesus, but were kept from recognizing him. And then when Jesus kind of revealed himself by breaking bread with them, he disappeared, and then these disciples rushed back to Jerusalem. So that's kind of the context for what's happening here in our gospel lesson for today. So we've got like three scenes. We've got the tomb, we've got the road to Emmaus, and we've got the upper room. The problem is the disciples were basically closed. Sorry, we're closed. And they were closed for various reasons. Of course, we know that the Bible describes elsewhere that they were in an upper room with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. We knew that from other passages in Scripture. So they certainly had the door shut and locked, just like a store would, with their closed sign in the window. But there are factors that kept these disciples closed on this most magnificent of days. The first was, sorry, we're not expectant. In other words, when the women were on their way to the tomb, they were not expecting a resurrection. In fact, we know that they were on their way to carry out some of the burial duties that in a rush hadn't been completed. They were on their way with ointments and spices and linens to continue the burial process of Jesus. They weren't expecting the stone to be rolled away. They weren't expecting messengers from heaven who said, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen as he said." And indeed, there were times that Jesus said, "The Son of Man must be crucified, but on the third day raised again." It was almost as if they didn't remember. But one of the issues that keeps Christians closed is that we don't have an expectation. You know, when God says something in His Word, when He makes a promise, when He issues a prophecy, we, of all people, should be on pins and needles expecting to see God work. You remember a few weeks ago when I shared that video of the Moke tribe in Papua New Guinea, and they received the gospel with great excitement, and they were just celebrating that their sins were forgiven. Do you remember that video? Some of you do. That was just a real amazing video. Well, those Moke people had such a strong but simple faith. A story is told of those same missionaries that went back to help them learn how to train to be evangelists in the other tribes. And so they met together the first night that the missionaries were back, and they had a prayer meeting. And while they were praying in this prayer meeting, Papua New Guinea had a pretty sizable earthquake. And all of the missionaries were running out from the buildings and huts. They were running out to get out in the clear. And the Moke tribe were sitting in the building going, "Wow, this is great!" Because they had read in the Bible that the disciples were gathered for prayer, and the building shook. They had an expectation that was completely fine. You and I are called to have some expectations of God because we know that He is faithful. We know that He is true. We know that when He has spoken, He has spoken and it will be done. The disciples were closed. Sorry, we're foolish and slow. When the disciples on the road to Emmaus, still pondering, still trying to figure out what had happened, what happened this morning? While they were talking, Jesus comes and walks up along them, and they're kept from recognizing him, and He just kind of brings a little discussion out of them, and they were talking about what's been going on in Jerusalem with Jesus and how they were amazed that some of the women said the tomb was empty, and boy, we just don't know what's going on. Jesus said to those disciples, "Oh, are you," he says right here, he said to them, "How foolish you are, how slow to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Did you not know the Messiah would have to suffer these things?" See, the disciples, though they knew what the prophets said, though they studied it and had some religious expectation that these words would somehow be fulfilled, it was like they missed it with Jesus. They were foolish. They were slow of heart, slow to catch on to what God was doing. In our world today, we Christians sometimes are not expectant of God, but sometimes we're just foolish and slow to miss all the things that God is doing and is fulfilling for us. It's like we should be looking for the things that happen in God's kingdom and expecting it, but we should also be recognizing it when it happens. Sometimes we're just closed because of our foolishness and slowness. Sometimes disciples are closed because we're afraid. Sorry, we're afraid. This was most certainly the case for those Christians who were gathered in the room. They were afraid. They were having a hard time understanding what was going on. More on that in a little bit. Sometimes we're doubting. So we doubt that something can be as God says, because our own senses tell us differently. These same disciples had witnessed Jesus in their presence as he celebrated the Passover with them. They saw Jesus arrested and taken away. They fled. They saw him crucified. One was right there at the foot of the cross with a few of the women. But they certainly know that he died. So with no expectation, with foolishness and slowness to take to heart what the scriptures have said, fearfully cowering in this room, they were also doubting. Jesus enters in their midst. That's what a setup for Jesus to appear in their midst. And I like to describe it this way. I think, you know, when Jesus was in his resurrected body, he was so real. You know, we're all made out of atoms and molecules, and you know, everything is just kind of floating and connected with each other. You know, that's the way the molecular structure is. I believe that Jesus was so solid and real, a door couldn't stop him, a wall couldn't stop him, being on the other side of the earth couldn't stop him. When he wanted to be with his disciples, he could just be with his disciples. And the Bible tells us it was while they were still discussing these things, while they were still discussing the tomb and the guys from Emmaus, while they were talking about these things, Jesus stood in their midst. And Jesus does a great thing. He greets them with the word, peace. Peace. That's a great word, by the way. There are places of business up north that are shut down, boarded up, closed up because there's chaos right now. Chaos. The Jewish word for peace, the word shalom, is a wonderful word. It means peace, roughly, but it means peace in this particular way. Those Hebrew letters are an acronym for the power destroying the authority causing chaos. And notice that there's a bunch of participles in there. It's the power that's acting right now, actively destroying the authority, like the supposed power that's causing chaos, that supposed power. It's the power that demolishes that authority that's causing chaos. And it's working right now for those who believe and trust in Jesus. Jesus walks into this room, and you can imagine that there's chaos. Chaos in their minds, in their hearts, the fear that they're experiencing. And Jesus says, "Peace be with you." They're so fearful that they're seeing a ghost. That Jesus does some pretty compassionate things. He opens them up. Those disciples who were closed needed to be opened up, and Jesus knew how to do it. He opened their eyes and their ears. "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your mind? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" What a great request. He was going to show them that I am fully alive, I am fully physical and present. Give me something to eat. And they watched Jesus consume a piece of broiled fish. Jesus knew that they needed a physical experience with him, to touch him, to see him, to hear him, to start making some sense of all this stuff. And then he opened their mind. And this is my favorite part. This is what really struck me as a main theme in this text. It's as though he really had to remind them, not only open their mind, but take their mind back to the things that he had said and taught. But he opened their minds so they could understand the scripture. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead, and on the third day, and repent and rise on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem." You know, we need our mind opened, not just so that we have a head knowledge of God's word, but that the word is beginning to make sense to us. It was great to be on the confirmation retreat last week and watch the lights go on for these young people who were in the word all weekend. We came back to our regular Wednesday night confirmation class, and Brogan Greensky was doing really, really well on our weekly Bible quiz. He was just nailing it. And of course, you get candy when you get the answers right. And Brogan couldn't have done better if he was trick-or-treating. He was just doing great. And everyone was like, "Man, Brogan, what's up with you?" And he goes, "3 days of church camp, man." 3 days of church camp. You know, to open your mind to understand the scriptures means that it's having an effect on your life. It's changing how you think. It's changing how you act. It's changing how you believe. We know that faith increases as the word of God is preached and taught and read and studied. And God loves to open our mind to understand the scriptures. That mind that you and I have is deep in us. The physical part of it is, of course, our brain. But the conscious part of it, the learning part of it, the relationship part of it, that part of it is deeper than even the brain can fully explain. That's because we are living creatures that God has made. Jesus did some work opening their spirit. He dealt with the physical, he dealt with the mental and emotional. He also deals with the spirit. He says to them, "You are my witnesses. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you've been clothed with power from on high." He was talking about the promise of the Holy Spirit. Now it wasn't just going to be the presence of the master, teacher, rabbi, the Lord Jesus. It wasn't just going to be the presence of him opening their minds so they could understand the scripture. He was telling them that a few days hence, there was going to be an outpouring of a gift that God would give them that would forever impact their mind and heart and soul. Stay in Jerusalem until you've been clothed with power from on high. God works with us on all levels and in powerful ways. And it is clear from these closing verses of Luke that we are to be people who have an open mouth. You are witnesses of these things. It means that God has given us his story, and he's made us part of his story so that we can tell others what God is doing and what he can do for them. Now, back to what I originally started with, this idea of being open for business. If the red sign is turned around and if we're closed because we're not expectant, because we're slow and foolish, because we're afraid, because we're doubting, if that red sign is flipped around, we come to the Lord Jesus seeking his forgiveness and his grace, knowing that he will help us, taking our sins to the cross and giving us a new life and a resurrected hope. That sign can be turned around, and we are open for business. And believe me, brothers and sisters, we've got business. I believe that we are to be opened by the Lord Jesus Christ through his word and through his spirit, because God has business to do in us. Scripture tells us that he gives us gifts so that we can serve him and serve others. I believe as we are open to the work of God, among those gifts are three big ones, three huge gifts described in 1 Corinthians 13. These three remain: faith, hope, and love. God grows our faith, he grows our hope, he grows our love as we are open to his word and spirit. Not only are we open for the business that God is doing in us, but we have business to do in God. Your baptism has made you available. We talked about this with our team leaders practically a year ago now, huh? Our baptism has made us available. We have four colors that are prominent in our church. One of them is white. And the doves, those doves, there's a dove up there for everybody who's been baptized here. It was down low, and I was reading dates from the 1800s. Wow. Or early 1900s, anyway. Wow. We are available. We have faith, hope, and love given to us in our baptism and in our availability. So we say here at Bethlehem, faith, hope, and love make us available to our neighbors near and far. I love the way Bethlehem gets that and the way Bethlehem pursues that mission. It's simple. It was born out of a group of leaders just sitting there talking. Some of you are in this room right now. You know that that wasn't imposed upon us. It came out of it. It came out of the discussion. It was just beautiful. And we can remember, faith is green, it grows, it's lush, it's living. Hope is blue, like the vastness of the sky and the width of the ocean and the world that we have to share the hope of Jesus Christ. Red, the color of our Lord and Savior's precious blood. Faith, hope, and love alongside us, in us, around us, makes us available to our neighbors near and far. We are open for business. Let's stay open for business. And I'm not talking about a sign on the door. I'm talking about a heart flung wide open to the Word of God and the power of His Spirit for Jesus' sake. Amen. Let's stand and speak together the Apostles' Creed as a statement of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We pray the Lord to help the blind. O Lord, open our eyes that we might see Your power and glory. Encourage us to be helpers to the physically or spiritually blind, so that all might come to see the goodness of Your love. Help us all to see the love of God for us in Christ Jesus. Lord, in Your mercy, we pray for everyday miracles. Holy God, You work miracles every day. Sometimes those miracles are profound and defy logic, and other times they are simple answers to prayers expressed in faith. Give us better understanding of Your ways so we would see the everyday miracles You perform around us. Lord, in Your mercy, we pray for suffering anywhere and everywhere. Heavenly Father, there are so many people around the world who are suffering from disease, hunger, poverty, or attacks from an enemy. Grant us strength and courage in the face of such trials. Give us hope in our hearts, and let us pass that hope on for the stricken and dejected. We pray especially for Randy, Mike, Harlan, Faith, Carolyn, Claire, and Dolores. Lord, in Your mercy. Almighty God, pour out Your Holy Spirit on the Church of Christ, which is His precious bride. Give to Your people the will to follow the Good Shepherd in word and deed, acting in kindness and trusting in his mercy in our lives and in the life of the church. Send us out into the world you love to make disciples of all types of people. Lord, in your mercy, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace, his shalom peace, destroying the authority that's causing chaos. Go in that peace. Amen. Let's stand and sing Living Hope. This was introduced on Easter Sunday. Let's sing it out.
Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one.
Wow, have a great week, everybody. Don't forget, we have a return to our fellowship time. Please be safe. Keep a social distance when you're in fellowship. Wear a mask if you feel comfortable with that. But we have fellowship once again. And Sunday school is over with at 11 o'clock. Remember that. You are free to go. God bless you. Have a terrific week.